I was at breakfast one day with my friend Charlie, and he started telling me about his father, Matt Rizzo. He always thought his father had been blinded in a hunting accident, until one day when he found out that that wasn't true. His father was actually in the Chicago outfit, the mafia in Chicago, and he had been blinded in a robbery shootout and ended up in Stateville Prison, where he became the cellmate of Nathan Leopold, who was in Chicago, a very famous criminal from the 20th century, early 20th century. He had committed what was at that time called the crime of the century. And I couldn't believe what Charlie was telling me. I said, "Charlie, I have to do something with this story." Charlie told me that Leopold had taught himself to read Braille so he could teach Matt Rizzo how to read. And then he immersed him in a classical education while he was in prison. And so I knew that Matt had been reading Homer and Virgil and Dante. And when I was doing my research, I saw a picture of Dante's Inferno that had these circles of hell. And that I also had done research on the prison, Stateville Prison, that Matt and Nathan were cellmates in, and it was built in the Panopticon design, so it was a circular prison with several, layers of its own hell in modern day prison. And when I saw those two images in my research, I thought, ah, perfect. This is how I can talk about their condition. And also, my protagonist, Matt Rizzo, was blind, and I wanted the reader to be able to see the world through Matt Rizzo's eyes, but he's blind, so how can I do that? And I thought, well, maybe we can go into his imagination, and that's how we can see the world as he sees it.
There's one two-page spread where, right after Matt Rizzo arrives at prison and he's leaning against the railing, and that's the first time you see the Panopticon design of the prison and all the circles, and that drawing I had to try three times before I got it right, and so that one definitely had a lot of problems that I had to work through, and was frustrating, but. As far as a most difficult, maybe mentally or endurance-wise, is right at the end where Matt and Nathan are going through the circles of hell, and there's four double-page spreads in a row, and so that was difficult. That was the most mentally difficult as far as trying to. Since there wasn't text for those pages, and so I really had to get into my imagination and try to figure out what was going on there, but also then having to confront all of the imagery of hell, or trying to keep think of, well, darker things. How can I make this darker? How can I? And then after doing the pencil drawings, then it was a couple weeks of just sitting there inking all those pages. So, I think mentally that sequence was the most difficult.
When Charlie first told me the story, I spent about another 6 months talking to him and finding out more about his father. I read his father's writings, and then I started in earnest to do research, reading Nathan Leopold's autobiography and the court transcripts and newspaper articles from the crimes of both Matt Rizzo and Nathan Leopold. And I started studying Dante. So it took me about 2 years to write the script that I gave to Landis to illustrate. Of course, he turned it into something amazing. It grew from there. In some ways, I kept writing the story with him, even though I was actually pulling out a lot of text because of the way his images were telling the story better than any text.
When I started working on the project with David, he gave me a screenplay, which I took, and for a couple months I worked on doing thumbnail sketches of all the pages in the book based on the screenplay, and David wanted me to just put my vision on the text, and so he kind of just let me be for those couple months and let me get out my first impression of what I was envisioning from the text. And after I'd done that, that's when the real collaboration with David started, because we, for about 3 months after that, we took those thumbnails and we blew them up larger onto and pinned them up onto storyboards in our studio, and we just every day would walk through the story, and every time we would come to a problem, we'd stop and talk about it, and we'd maybe insert some new images or new pages, or rewrite some of the text. And in that 3 months or so, that's when the most collaboration happened with the project, because we were talking so intensely about the story that it's hard to remember what David suggested and what I suggested. And that's when I feel like the book really came alive and became its own independent thing of both David's vision and my vision.
I was looking for an illustrator that could take my script and turn it into a graphic novel. So I went to a comic convention in Chicago and was walking up and down Artist Alley, where all the artists have a table and they're selling their drawings and things. And in America, there's a lot of superhero kind of images and comics and things. And I wasn't really interested in this. But when I saw what Landis was doing with pen and ink, I was really interested in that. So I got a little card from his table at that convention, and I brought it back with me to the office and called him a week later, and we began to talk about the story. And then we eventually started working on it together.
I'd spent 3 years doing the drawings of the book, so it was a long process, but that was part of the collaboration with David, though, that was also so special, is that we had the space to let the story turn into something on its own, and so we were letting the story tell us what to do. And so even though the book kept getting longer and longer, and we kept inserting more pages, even late in the process when we think we had it, and then we would have a discussion and realize, wait, no, we should really add this, and then suddenly there's four more pages, here and there. And so while that made the project very long, it made it very rich. And I think that's why the story now connects with people, is because we let it sit and develop naturally, I suppose.
Well, this is a very complicated page, because I wasn't quite sure how Landis was going to express it in pen and ink. It was important to me because it talked about the importance of poetry and how everyone is a poet. These writers that have written through the centuries, the great writers of Western civilization have written these amazing works of literature that still bring shed light on our condition today. And so I was trying to find a way to express that. And what's really fun about this page is that I remember one day bringing in this quote from Ralph Waldo Emerson. It's actually the last paragraph in his essay called The Poet. And I said, Landis, listen to this. And I read it to him. And We ended up talking, I think, for a couple of hours about the ideas that that this passage was suggesting or offering to us, and so it was really great that Landis found a way to actually take that part of Emerson's essay and actually incorporate it into the page. So it's just, I think this page really sums up for me the power of literature and why it's important that we listen to the voice of the poet, or as Matt Rizzo would say, the secret language of the poet.
This spread has become one of my favorite pages in sequences in the book, but it took an interesting route in getting there, because it's a very special point in the book where it's supposed to show the connection of Leopold, I suppose the fatal connection between Leopold and Loeb, and how it was a perfect unification of kind of the wrong things that created these monsters, so to speak, and they were misinterpreting Nietzsche as they, and so this scene was supposed to depict them coming together with Nietzsche, and so we were trying to visually come up with a way of showing this, and I had done a pencil drawing, the full pencil drawing, of what I thought would be a good image for this, and when I showed it to David, he wasn't so sure about it, and he kind of kept saying, I don't know if this is doing it, and we had a long discussion about it, and he kept saying, no, I think you should try something else, and I didn't want to try something else, and I was being stubborn for a while and resisting him, and finally said, okay, fine, I'll try something else, and I tried something else, and then, as I said, it's become one of my favorite pages in the book, and that's another good example of the collaboration of that David knew when to push me to dig deeper into my imagination in order to better tell the story, and whereas I was happy with the previous result, it now when I look back, we still have the pencil drawing of the one that I didn't ink, and when I've looked at it, I think, why in the world did I ever think this was this was good enough to ink? So,
yeah, Favdo, oh, vive la France! That was so amazing, so surprising that we won that prize. I couldn't believe it. It was really, really humbling, actually, to be recognized in France for this work that we had done. It was just very mind-blowing.
I was not expecting it. It was a big surprise. And I don't, I honestly don't feel like I belong on that list when I see the other people on who have won that award. But so, extreme gratitude, I suppose, for the people of France that they love this book so much, and it's something very special to be a part of.